So here we go then. Minutes to kick off. Pulse of Luton in our 12:30 kick-off in the Championship finished 0-0 at Fratton Park. But Weymouth away at Hemel Hempstead will cross over first to that one. National League, or at home to Hemel Hempstead, I should say. National League South. Smart speaker and BBC Sounds. Ian Hutchinson, your summariser. Commentary from Cliff Pledge.
Thank you, Ian. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Bob Lucas Stadium. Always some excitement for the first home competitive fixture of a new season. And Weymouth get the chance to play in front of their own supporters in a National League South game for the first time in the new season 24-25. Hemel Hempstead Town, the visitors today. Some irony maybe that Bobby Wilkinson, former Weymouth manager, coming back as early as the opportunity would allow to take his new side, Hemel Hempstead, here at the Bob Lucas Stadium. Weymouth started with a 3-2 defeat on the road at Tunbridge Angels. The Tudors had a rousing comeback. They drew 2-2 at home to Salisbury, coming from two down to get that point. So they've got a point on the board. The Terrors still to achieve that. Both teams will see this as a winnable fixture, I am sure. We've got about a dozen union flags held by local children down on the tunnel. Union flags with a bit of the terracotta colours of Weymouth FC. Here come the two sides. Weymouth in light blue with the famous terracotta on the shoulders and the shorts. And Hemel Hempstead Town are all in green today. Referee Gary Parsons. Seen quite a few games he's done. Let's have a look at the two teams. Billy Terrell keeps goal for Weymouth today. Brooklyn Genesini and Ben Greenwood will be the fullbacks. Jordan Thompson and Corey Jordan in the centre of defence. Josh McCoy's back in the team for Weymouth, 34 years old. He's in the middle with Charlie Rowan and Tom Bearwish. And then Francis Amati and Ewan Pollock up front supporting the main forward, Malachi Linton. Substitutes, Leo Hamblin, Andreas Robinson, Ezio Torre, Calvin Brooks. Assuming that Keelan's got any...
The sound.
The sound of.
The sound of the South.
And all the music you love.
BBC Radio Solent.
The referee's making sure everybody's ready. And sounds the whistle for the season to get underway at the Bob Lucas Stadium. Weymouth in possession, playing it up from defence. And a good header one immediately by Hemel, who get it clear. Ian Hutchinson is the summariser today. Former Weymouth player, former Weymouth manager. Good afternoon, Hutch. What do you expect from today's game?
Good afternoon, Cliff. Good afternoon, everyone. It's going to be a tasty affair, isn't it? Obviously, with the return of Bobby Wilkinson. Two different contrasting styles.
We'll break away because Weymouth have an early attack with Linton. Good ball finds him out on the right wing. He's forced to go back to Genesini, who's overlapping and wins a corner. plays it off of Wishart. And it's a corner. That's a really good start from Weymouth.
Yeah, good start. And we've known Genesini, the new right back, he'll be getting forward a lot. As a right back, he's not your average full back. He gets forward, he attacks. And a very positive start there for Weymouth.
Well, corner to come in from the right hand side here at the Bob Lucas Stadium. We've got everybody. Almost everyone in the penalty, lots of people in the 6-yard box. Keeper's going to struggle. The corner's over hit, and it's going to be very difficult for Thompson to try and keep that one in. That was a bit of a waste and an arm up for an apology from Ewan Pollock, who took that early corner.
Yeah, too many Weetabix, I think, for Pollock this morning, but another good addition to the Weymouth squad. Interesting to see how the goes, I say. Two contrasting styles. Mark Moseley likes to get the ball down and play, so it'll be good to see a bit of stylish football back at the Bob Lucas.
Yeah, that's a point, because I know we thought some of Bobby Wilkinson's results were great here, but you did comment last season that perhaps it wasn't always the most stylish football for you.
No, it wasn't very easy on the eye, but that's no disrespect to Bobby.
Here come Weymouth again. Good chance into the middle, a dribble and dribble into the side netting. Francis Amati with a terrific dribble from the left flank in towards the 6-yard box. And his shot flashed into the side netting of the near post. Weymouth really on a bright start here. They've had a corner, they've had a shot just off target. It's still 0-0 here in the second minute, but maybe he could have done Brian.
Yeah, he's hit the side net and maybe he could have looked to square it. But again, positive from Martin, positive from Weymouth. As I say about Bobby's start, wasn't easy on the hour, but that was his way.
Right in front of the referee, free kick to Hemel Hempstead. It was Ben Greenwood sliding in and catching Dan Wishart. And it's one of his teammates getting him back up on his feet, giving him a little slap to the face. A late tackle, but I don't think there was too much intent in that. I think it was just mistimed. And just looking at the changes that were made. When we went through the teams earlier, Keelan O'Connell misses out of the squad. He played 75 minutes at Tunbridge on the opening day. And Josh McCoy back into the team. 34 years old, former Bournemouth star. And then that leaves a place on the bench which Farid Salifu takes. Salifu impressed in a pre-season trial, former Gosport forward. Free kick taken quickly by the Tudors. George Williams is down the left wing, delivers a good ball into the area, but Bearwish got there before anyone else and clears for Weymouth, who now are on attack of their own down this right touchline. Malachi Linton getting the better of Jack Davies, roared on by the crowd here at the Bob Lucas. On the right wing, good delivery into the area, good clearance though, as Hemel got everybody back and the defender hooked it away. I think it was the former player Teddy Howe who got the last touch on that one. It's a throw to Weymouth, who've made a very good start. Teddy Howe, the only player leaving Weymouth to go to Hemel in the summer. I don't know if we thought Bobby might take more players. A shame that they didn't keep hold of Teddy Howe.
I didn't get that.
Throw for Weymouth, out on this right-hand side. Genesini gets the ball back, tries to dribble past Chris Smith. Chris Smith gets a long ball away. Weymouth deal with it and send it straight back into the danger area. Up for grabs now in the middle of the park. Bit of head tennis from both teams. Will there be a bit of quality to bring the ball under control? Here it comes, maybe, from Brandon Barzi. Great dribble, great ball forward to the right-hand side. A chance to shoot from the edge of the chance from Teddy Howe, maybe. Howe turns. He didn't fancy the shot. Gets it back to Ricky German. Out to Howe on the right wing. Former Weymouth player. Gets past the defender. Turns. He's going to have to try and get past him again. Gets it back to German. German's low shot is blocked and behind for a corner off of Corey Jordan. That's one corner each here at the Bob Lucas. 5 minutes in and 0-0. I was saying about Teddy Howe, Hutch, about only one player leaving Weymouth to join Bobby at Hemel. Was it? He always struck me as being a pretty solid player, dependable.
Yeah, it was a big surprise to me. I thought he was up and down, Teddy Howe, good young lad, worked hard and had a good right peg on him and got forward. So it was a big surprise, but good acquisition for Bobby.
Corner is in from Hemel. Number six tries to flick it. A shot comes in from the edge of the air from George Williams, which was miscued. Chris Smith tried to backheel the ball in the area when the corner reached him. Went out of the box to Williams, whose shot came to nothing. Now Craig King's got it all the way back in his goal. Out to Teddy Howe. Teddy Howe's in. Plays the 1-2. Ajay now out to the right wing to Jack Davies. Davies wearing number two but playing left back. Launches it long and the Terrace get it out of play for a throw. We're also going to try and check in on the scores of all our non-league sides in the south. We'll look at East League in the league above. We look in the league below. We've got six Hampshire teams and three Dorset teams this year in the Southern League. We'll try and give out scores in this league as well, and FA Cup qualifying scores if the action allows us as the afternoon goes on. It's the two number 11s clashing in the centre circle, and it was a tweak of the shirt, I think, and it's a free kick to Hemel. Amati fouling Barzi. Can't really have too many complaints. Right in front of the referee and a free kick to Hemel. How have you seen them? You're better on the tactics than me, Hutch. How have they lined up in your eyes, both teams' formations so far?
Well, we were just discussing this before the game. Formations these days, it's not your atypical 4-4-2 and there's different ones. But at first we thought Weymouth were sort of doing the old 4-2-3-1, but then we think they've gone in with three centre-halves, with Thompson, Corey and Rowan, because Rowan normally can sit in front of the back four with Tom Bearwish, but it looks as though McCoy's doing that with Bearwish, and you've got the two wide sort of wing backs. So we think that's what it is at the moment. So it might be a bit of a change up from Mark Moseley there.
We understand Mark will be watching up here in the stands somewhere. Understand there's still a touchline ban from last season. This is a good attack from Hemel. Chiruli's got the ball. Dribbling, takes a shot, it's blocked by Thompson. Still in possession, out on the right-hand side. Barzi, cross hits the back of a Weymouth player. He might get a chance to win the ball back, finds a teammate. Passing it nicely now in Weymouth's half. They weathered an early storm of 2 or 3 minutes of home pressure. Now they're showing what they can do. Barzi out to the right-hand side. Good low cross, but it's Terrors who get there first. And Corey Jordan gets it away. Corey Jordan, a summer signing from Gosport Borough from the Southern Football League. He had a loan spell here at Weymouth when he was a Bournemouth player. Well, a bit of a casual pass along their defence from Hemel, but Weymouth couldn't pick up on any loose ball. And now, and on this near side to the captain, Dan Wishart, now with Williams. Davies and Williams wearing 2 and 3 but playing alongside each other out on this left hand side. Kyle Ajay at the back. Well, at the moment they're passing it rather in a controlled and measured way. Out on the right hand side, Weymouth. Nice ball to try and chase, but over hit from Barzi, looking to find Cerulli. And a goal kick to the Terrors. Ian, what for you would be success for Weymouth? They were 15th last time. A similar finish is what we should expect, or does the return of Mark Moseley change expectations?
I think it does change expectations, but again, we've got to be realistic. I think Mark Moseley, his first time around, was absolutely magnificent in what he did. I like him as a person as well, very much so, gentleman. I mean, I said 14th, to be honest, when someone asked me, but should be doing better than that. I mean, he's got his links with Bournemouth again, to see he plays a nice brand of football, but it ain't always the same the second time around, is it? So we'll have to wait and see, but it'll be intriguing, but obviously hope they do very well and hope Mark has a second successful spell at the club.
And, here's an attack from the visitors. Cerulli is about 30 yards out, tries to play in a forward, it's easily intercepted and cleared by Corey Jordan up towards Amati, who's fouled the defender. He tried to turn him, but ref sees a foul. Quick continuation. They took it quickly, did Hemel Hempstead. George Williams in the centre, looking to go out to the left-hand side, just touches it off to Wishart. back to Chris Smith. Ajay to Wissart, the captain. Then Ajay forward, but Bearwish wins the header. Then a push in the back, but referee didn't see that. He was looking at the front of Ben Greenwood, didn't see the push in his back. The crowd did. And Hemel a bit fortunate there not to concede a free kick and get it away. Weymouth made a lightning start, but it's a fairly... Oh, that's a... Surely that's a foul there. The ref didn't spot it. Hemel carry on with an attack. The Germans into the penalty area. Dribbles, does extremely well to get past Thompson. Wins the corner. Couldn't get past Jordan. Corner to Hemel. I think Hemel have got better as the game's gone on.
Absolutely. They've taken a foot all of the game. Weymouth started very positively first few minutes, but Hemel keeping the ball well as well. And German up front there doing ever so well. Quite a cumbersome looking sort of player, his style of player. But a real danger man for Weymouth, for Hemel, should I say again.
George Williams is going to take this corner. It's the second one Hemel have got. This time it's on this near touchline on the left-hand side as we look at it. Everyone's bunched at the far post. Where's the delivery going to come from Williams? Floats into the middle. There was a head and what looked might have been a hand from Weymouth, but it's gone all the way through to the other side for a throw. And there was a touch because it's a throw to Hemel up by the corner flag on the opposite side from where the corner came in. But in the build-up to that corner, it seemed there was a bit of hesitation there from Weymouth at the back. It looked a little bit like they stopped and almost... allowed a good chance for Hemel.
Yeah, I think they were waiting for the ref's whistle. I think we all thought it was a foul, but he played on, and that's one thing you do, you've got to play to the whistle. And certainly Weymouth didn't there, and they nearly got caught out.
Terrific header is into the net. A brilliant cross from the right, and Kyle Ajayi was up with a free header, booming it into the bottom left-hand corner, and Billy Tyrrell is beaten. Hemel were getting stronger. They've had the game's first good chance and they've taken the lead. Weymouth 0, Hemel Hempstead Town 1.
Free header, simple as that. Ball in, goal. No one marking him. Really poor defending from Weymouth. Mark Mosley will be really disappointed with that. That's a gift for Hemel Hempstead, although they have been getting into the game and they've been the better side, but that is a gift.
Well, Weymouth made had a bright couple of minutes, but it's been Hemel said team leading here at the Bob Lucas. Well, the a free kick to Weymouth, a little bit of needle there. It was George Williams on Tom Bearwish, and if it wasn't given, Williams might have been able to run through, but it was a foul. It is a free kick to Weymouth, who find themselves a goal behind here. So with Mark Molesley, if he's not on the touchline today, Bradley Asegba with the cap on there, his assistant manager, taking the team. And Charlie Rowan at the back for Weymouth, back to his keeper, Billy Tyrrell. And long ball forward from the keeper. Linton's trying to chase it. Malachi Linton out on the right hand side into the area. Could be chance for Genesini to the back post, and it loops behind for a corner. Ben Tompkins got the last touch. There were two players waiting for the delivery. It was a really good cross, but Tompkins got there before those two terrors. And a corner which Ewan Pollock is going to take out on the left hand side. Could this be a chance for an instant equaliser for Weymouth? Corner comes in from Pollock. It swirls down. Thompson wins a header. Hemel win a second one. McCoy plays it out to the left wing. Ball in and a good header at the back gets it away for Hemel. Now they try to attack, but they're easily intercepted by Genesini, who plays a parallel ball along the halfway line. Out on the left. Haven't got too much space out there. At the moment there. Terrace keeping the ball, but what can they do with it? Charlie Rowan looks up. What are his options? Is he going to play a long ball forward? He plays a long ball out to the left-hand side, and it's volleyed out of play, a hopeful one from Francis Amati, and behind for a goal kick. And the referee going over, the referee's gone over to talk to one of the Weymouth players. Maybe, did he leave the field and he needs permission to come back on? He's got to change his shorts, I think. Genesini, I don't know what's happening there. He needs a new pair of shorts. And the ref was giving him some words of advice how he should have done that one. A Weymouth player is down holding his head for a push maybe off the ball. Good atmosphere here, Hutch, today. I don't know how many fans have come through the turnstiles. They might tell us later on, but good atmosphere always helps.
Yeah, it is. I mean, in August, early doors, people are still on holiday, aren't they? And they like to go down the beach in the summer. But yeah, I'd say 900 to 1,000 maybe. Nice little contingent from Hemel as well. It's a bit of a check for them, but impressed me, Hemel, actually. They've been very organised. The Bobby Wilkinson team, they're in your face, just like Bobby Wilkinson is. Bench, he hasn't changed at all. He's up and down that bench. So, been very impressed with Hemel at the start.
And is it good? Is it nice to see that Bobby got a club almost straight away after leaving Weymouth?
Yeah, it was an interesting one, wasn't it? Bobby's sacking sort of left under a bit of a cloud, really. Fans were kept in the dark. There was no statements, no real statements from either parties, really. Bobby just seemed to be out the door, and that was it, and we don't really know. And it was a bit disappointing, really. I feel the fans deserve a bit better than an explanation. Obviously something's gone on, but that's football, and you move on, didn't you? And you know, he was Weymouth through and through last season, and now he's Hemel Hempstead through and through. But that's football.
Yeah, it's superbly well at other clubs before Weymouth, where he of course helped engineer a great escape from relegation. Here it's 1-0 to Hemel with that header from Kyle Ajayi. Hemel looking for a second goal, working it nicely out of the right hand side, crossing it in low. Charlie Rowan puts it out for a corner to the visitor. Weymouth making a slow start last week, having to in that fixture, and at times being a couple of goals down before getting back a consolation. Here they are, one behind, as the corner comes in from, we're going to wait. The referee wants to, there's a bit of jostling in the 6-yard box before the Tudors can take this corner. And we're going to see a change already for Weymouth. Oh no. Corey Jordan had to change his shorts, I think. That's what it was. Looks like a sub's coming on, but he had to go off and come back on. He'll come back in time for this corner for Hemel. Delivered from the right, curled in. Good header one by Rowan. Still loose in the area. It's hooked towards goal. Shot comes in. Good save from Terrell. And another shot comes in, and it's deflected wide. That's going to be a goal kick while the ref's given a corner. I think it was Chris Smith who had the shot, and it was a good save from Terrell.
Yeah, good effort from Smith, volley on the turn, and good save from Terrell. You'd expect him to make that save, but then again, good save from the young lad. Another new young acquisition for Mark Moseley.
The new goalkeeper beaten once today and making a good goal on loan from the Cherries, where of course Mark Moseley was once a player. Corner comes in from Hemel, floated to the back post, header down, it's beaten away, saved again. And a big appeal for a penalty has been a goal kick. Well, it looked, when the referee points for a goal kick and he's near the penalty spot, it looks almost like the same thing. But Terrell was caught into action there again. It's looking good for Hemel this afternoon, although it is now a free kick to Weymouth down the right-hand side, and some words between Malachi Linton of Weymouth and Dan Wishart of Hemel. And a free kick to Weymouth on the right-hand side. Wishart coming in from Hampton and Richmond in the summer. Played in the league for Forest Green. I saw him play on loan at Eastleigh. 10 games there earlier in his career. He's had lots of non-league clubs. Very experienced. But seemingly upset in Linton there. There were words after the whistle, and the referee wants to talk to both of them to get them to calm down a little bit. Good atmosphere here, trying to urge Weymouth onto an equaliser. We are trailing 1-0 here at the Bob Lucas Stadium to Hemel Hempstead Town. Genesini and Pollock stand over the ball. Who's going to take the free kick here out on the right-hand side? It is Genesini, and it's too easily cleared. Wasn't the best delivery. Barzi with a hopeful ball up. It's actually gone behind him. He might get a clearance, a header on his own clearance, which is bizarre. But this is Amati for Weymouth. Plays an interesting ball in the area. Flick header from Hemel. Second header from Hemel. Cross comes in from Weymouth. Jordan's cross is blocked. And now it's right down in front of us by the two dugouts. And here comes Cerulli, touching it inside to German. German off the bench last week to get an equaliser against Salisbury. He starts today. Out to the right-hand side to Teddy Howe. We know that Howe can deliver a good cross from his Weymouth days. Working it nicely. And then German tries to leave it for Cerulli. They weren't on the same wavelength. Weymouth clear the ball. Obviously, you expect a pitch to be immaculate on the opening day. What did you make of the Bob Lucas pitch?
Yes, looking good. Another groundsman, good set of lads, and they were tirelessly hard day in, day out, even through pre-season as well. So, yeah, the pitch is looking very good. I think they watered it very early. Mark Mosley likes it watered, get a bit of zip on the surface for their passing game, which unfortunately they haven't found at the moment. Been very bitty from Weymouth so far.
Other scores in the Southern League, it's Poole Town 0 AFC Tottenham 1, Scott Rendell scoring, and of course Charlie Austin, the big signing for Tottenham. He is going back to Poole Town today. He's been a sub the first two games. I don't know if he'll start today, if he started, but Poole Town is where he began his non-league journey. And in the FA Cup, Baffin's Milton Rovers 1-0 up against Shepton Mallet, with Therese Lucanamoy scoring for Baffin's, who of course have got another player in Brett Pittman this season, a former Football League star for Pompey and the Cherries. Here it's 1-0 to Hemel, who attacked down the right-hand side. And that's a terrific ball into the path of the number three, who didn't shoot. He crossed it for Cerulli. And I don't think that was the best option there for Wishart, from about 8 yards out on a good angle. Then the keeper was across his goal. Surely he should have shot. He curled a good cross in, but it didn't find a teammate.
Yeah, disappointing from Wishart. Another great opportunity. Great work from Teddy Howe coming across the pitch and sliding him in. And Wishart, very experienced campaigner as well, should have done better there.
1-0. The Tudors lead at the Terrace. Only two real chances, I think, to talk about. The header for the goal. A good header, but an unmarked one. Kyle Ajayi giving Hemel the lead. And then a shot saved by Billy Terrell to keep out Chris Smith. So the two best chances so far for Hemel, who've won a throw up by the corner flag. You want to make the Bob Lucas Stadium a fortress, really. They were good for a couple of minutes, but I think Hemel have settled nicely into this game.
Yeah, better side, Cliff, by a shadow of a doubt. Really, really have played well. Taking a hold of the game. They're very strong, very positive. As I say, typical Bobby Wilkinson team. But they have knocked the ball around. You've got to give them that. They have got some passes in which Weymouth haven't done at all. And you'd expect that from Weymouth, the stylish football, brand of football that Mark Mosley wants to play. I still think they're crying out for this midfielder in the centre of the park who pulls the strings, can pass the ball, bring players in, hit a 50-yard pass. And I've said that for, well, all of last season. And I'm sure Mark's looking to add to the squad as well.
Weymouth were 15th last time out. Hemel stayed up with two games to go. Bobby Wilkinson taking charge for the last day. A goalless draw at Taunton that helped send Taunton down. Weymouth have a free kick in the centre circle here. And maybe they'll get a chance to get players forward. New players, you saw the friendly with Dorchester. You're seeing their first competitive home game here. I think it's about half a dozen new players that made a debut last Saturday. What have you made of the newer signings that Mark has made?
They're decent signings, no doubt about that, but we haven't seen the best of him as yet. I say I saw the Dorchester game yet. It's a pre-season friendly. They're just getting a pattern of play that Mark Moseley wants. But yeah, it's been disappointing so far, certainly against Dorchester. They look the team of strangers, really. But it takes time, and you know, I wouldn't look at the league until 10 games in, and then you make a measure of where they're at. And I'm sure Mark's on that training ground working very hard to get the system, get the pattern he wants.
Weymouth on the attack. Genesini finds Thompson, who's crossed from the right, is blocked, going to give a throw to Weymouth. Genesini, one of the new players coming in, a right back for, was at Swindon Town last season. Ewan Pollock and Ben Greenwood were let go by AFC Bournemouth are in. Corey Johnson signed. There are new signings as well. Weymouth on the Weymouth free kick. You can see there's a little bit of needle there, and it's going to be a free kick to Weymouth. Fourth official Craig Scriven is going to have to keep his eye on things on this touch. Genesini puts the free kick down. It's in between the two dugouts. It's right on this byline. His first couple of free kicks sort of curled a little bit before their target. Will this one be a bit stronger? No, it's a really poor kick, and it's easily cleared by Barzi. Out to German, out on the right-hand side. Genesini not hitting the spot so far from the set pieces. German wins the throw, the ball last coming off Ben Greenwood. Throw taken quickly. Chris Smith works it out to the right-hand side. Now they're looking to get it into the centre. Wishart's got it. Left mid. Sweeps the ball into the air towards German. It's a good header to get that one away by Corey Jordan at the back. He needed to win that header. That was a good cross, and it wins Hemel a throw out on the right side. Yeah. We sort of need a Weymouth attack to wake the crowd up again at the moment. It's Hemel winning set piece after set piece in Weymouth's half.
Yeah, the natives are restless as usual up in this stand. We know them well, but they want to see better. They want to see a vast improvement from Weymouth. I'd like to see Genesini on this right-hand side getting in the game more, get the ball out to him, let him have a go at the opposing fullback. But it's been very, as I say, bitty, scrappy from Weymouth, not getting many passes together, not many getting many combinations. And Hemel are just lapping it up at the moment.
Tompkins gets it forward. Chris Smith out to the, I think it's Teddy Howe overlapping into the area. Weymouth clear it up to the middle. Then there's a collision. It looked accidental. Play carries on. Hemel sweep it back into the area. German couldn't go for it. He knew he was offside. And Billy Terrell on loan from Bournemouth gets it away. What do you make of the decision to, on the eve of the season, to sign a new keeper in Terrell and let Gerard Benfield go out on loan to Dorchester?
Yeah, it was interesting whether Mark Moseley was trying to get someone in earlier. I think Benfield is a very good keeper, and I think Dorchester have done very well to get him, and it's a good acquisition for them, although he's just dislocated his, or broken his fingers, I believe, so he's out at the moment. But it's obviously an area Mark wanted to strengthen, and he feels Terrell's the man to do that, another sort of connection of his. So he's done well, what I've seen. I like him, young lad as well. So yeah, it's a good acquisition, and it's all about strength and depth as well at this level.
Corner to the visitors, 1-0 up. I don't know if we should say comfortably so, but I don't know if we could say who's the team most likely to score the next goal. It just seems to be comfortable stuff from Hemel. We're just biding their time for the chances to come. Weymouth haven't had too many chances. As of yet, they've not tested the visiting goalkeeper, Craig King. This is at least the fourth corner. Swept into the near post. Keeper's out, gathers it. Good handling from Billy Terrell, who had to gather that as it was almost above and past him. So a good take. And now Thompson gets forward to Genesini of Weymouth on this near touchline. Back to Bearwish. Back to Rowan. Finds McCoy. McCoy turns and plays it out to Greenwood. now in the middle with Rowan. Again, they're going long. There's nobody up there. This will be easy for Hemel as long as they don't make a mistake. They clear up to the middle. And Barzi tried to flick the header on, but Greenwood picks it up. Jordan and Greenwood combine. Now, Corey Jordan. Don't know if you've seen the highlights of any of the games. I watched this morning Hemel's comeback against Salisbury and Weymouth's game at Tunbridge on the opening day. And don't know if you've seen any of those. It was that's a foul for Weymouth on the left wing. It's a free kick in a very dangerous position. The Weymouth player looks hurt, and it might be the game's first caution. It's definitely the game's first talking to for Ben Tompkins. It is a yellow card for Tompkins. The 19-year-old defender to the book. Now, looking at the highlights, I think Terrell should have done better with the first goal that Tunbridge scored. But Sean Shields was amazing. He must have really wanted to put one over on Weymouth. He scored one and had a terrific game. Free kick to Weymouth. The referee...
Mark Moseley up in the stands, I believe he is, will have his notepad, and he'll have quite a bit on that notepad, I would have thought.
Yeah, we're getting 32 minutes on past 3 o'clock on a Saturday. Weymouth, a couple of encouraging bursts, but no real efforts as yet on the goal of Hemel Hempstead Town, who lead from a 13th minute header and comfortably leading through Kyle Ajayi's goal. Now their keeper Craig King floats a ball up, which Bearwish wins back into the Hemel half. Aren't Weymouth going to be able to get on the end of it? They just seem to have enough numbers back that Weymouth don't seem to look to have a way through. Now they're playing a nice ball out to Cerulli. Wishart's up helping him on the left hand side. Weymouth have got enough numbers back for now. But Williams has it. George Williams, very experienced player. Barzi and Wissart. This is a good, strong, sweeping cross. It's too long in the end. Too strong. Teddy Howe can't get on the end of that. 12 to the break. 1-0 to Hemel. Just going to take a look at scores elsewhere. We know that in the early kickoff, Portsmouth and Luton was 0-0. And not necessarily a bad thing. Pompey a point against the team just relegated out of the Premier League. Bournemouth are 1-1 at Nottingham Forest, and Southampton are 0-0 at Newcastle. Here Hemel lead 1-0. German in the penalty area bursted. Cerulli and German linking up well. Weymouth get it away in the National League. Let's take a look at Eastleigh. Eastleigh have won their opening game, but they are 2-0 down at home to AFC Fylde in their first home game. So they went to Maidenhead and won on the opening day 2-0. But Calvin Davis's team are 2-0 down at home to AFC Fylde. Also in that league, Forest Green 2 up at Boston, Aldershot 1 up at Halifax, Sutton 2, Altrincham 0. The only games with goals in the Vanarama National League. In a moment we'll have a look at the National League South. Here is a free kick to Hemel, who are looking good for their 1-0 lead. It's floated down the right wing towards Barzi. He must have got the last touch, or there was no touch because it's out of play for a throw. Amati put the pressure on him, and it's a throw to Weymouth right back by the corner flag of the goal they're defending. So Corey Jordan's gone over to take it. and they find themselves a goal behind and not creating very much at all this afternoon. It's a good throw, must be about 20, 30 yards forward, and he's nodded out of play, so he's gained about 10 yards by the time the header comes back. At the moment, they haven't, I mean, Linton looks dangerous when he gets the ball, but they haven't really worked the ball anywhere near the forwards so far.
No, I can't think of a good opportunity for Weymouth. It's very, very flat out there. You can tell that by the crowd as well. No spark at all. It's a case of one of the players rolling the sleeves up and making something happen, because at the moment it isn't for Weymouth.
Now they're working through the middle. McCoy plays it to Thompson. To Genesine. Bearwish in the middle, bursts into Hemel's half. Plays a nice ball out to the left-hand side. This could be a dangerous. This is Amati dribbling, takes a shot. The keeper touches it behind for a corner. It almost looked like it was...
ball to Martin. He's had a decent shot. Keeper should have done better, really. He's fumbled it a bit and pushed it wide, but better from Weymouth.
First chance to score. Will there be another from the corner? Delivered low to the near post. Flicks across, headed away. Barzi heads it out. Who's it going to fall to on the edge of the area? It's McCoy, but couldn't clear, get it up to find his teammates. And Hemel go forward. German flagged offside. Ref will allow play to continue here at the Bob Lucas Stadium, where it is Weymouth 0, Hemel 1. Not really a classic, leading by a well-taken header, an unmarked header. Looking the better tied, but Weymouth just getting themselves back into this one. Could be a chance here. The shot is blocked, coming in from Greenwood. Ball away. Other scores in the National League South: Averley 1, Tunbridge 0, Bath 1, Welling 0, Chelmsford 0, Hampton 1, Chesham 0, Boreham Wood 1, Dorking and Chippenham 0-0, Enfield 1, Weston 0, Farnborough 1, Torquay 0, Hornchurch 0, Eastbourne 1, Maidstone 0, Truro 1, Salisbury 1, Slough 0, St Albans 1, Worthing 1. And this game, of course, is 1-0 to Hemel. Every game has got a goal except the Dorking Chippenham game, although there might be some delayed information there from the BBC Sport website. Malachi Linton for Weymouth crosses it into the back post. It was a really intelligent cross, but Craig King was alert to the danger, and Hemel's goalkeeper grabbing the ball with both hands just as it looked like an inventive cross from the right-hand side was going to find ahead of one of his Weymouth teammates.
Yeah, decent from Linton, but he's a striker. We want him in the box, we really do. Mark Moores would be looking for him, playing between that 18-yard box, getting on the end of things, scraps, etc., because he's the goal scorer, and that's where he needs to be, not wide putting balls in. Should be others, men like Genesini, as I say. Haven't seen enough of him coming up the right and getting balls in and joining in, and down the other side as well with Greenwood.
Thinking there might be a mismatch with the squad, the team sheet numbers, some of the players out there, which doesn't help. Pushing the back on Dan Wishart gives a free kick to Hemel out on the left wing. Yeah, I think we've got 16 and 15 round the wrong way, so Greenwood and Pollock.
I'm glad you said that, Cliff. I was waiting for you to say it, because I was thinking I was going mad, to be honest, but I'm sure it is the wrong way around, isn't it? Do look quite similar from a distance.
I think it was the positions that gave it away in the end. George Williams is going to take this, the left winger, 28 years old. Hemel, deliver a good ball into the air. Headed away once and twice by Weymouth, back into the middle of the field. Teddy Howe takes his time and floats a really good ball out to Williams, who's shows some control, gets a bit of luck with a deflection and crosses it into the area. Weymouth headed away. Hemel still keep the ball. George Williams is going to have another go at this. Bearwish knocks him over. And it's a free kick to Hemel. Can't really complain about that, or the crowd don't seem to like it. Williams, a full Welsh international, signed a couple of years ago from Boreham Wood. He's got 7 caps to his name for Wales and has played for Fulham, amongst others, in his career. And I think he's going to leave this free kick to Dan Wishart. Is he going to take a shot from distance? He does, and it's over the top, and it's over the stand, and new ball is needed, please. 4 minutes to go, I think, and it is still 1-0 to Hemel. Not too much to write home about in this half, but it's been comfortable stuff from Hemel. We've got so many teams in the Southern League. Let's have a look how they are doing. Basingstoke 0, Dorchester 0, Gloucester 0, Wimborne 0, Havant and Waterlooville 0, Plymouth Parkway 1, Pool Town 0, AFC Totten 1, with Rendell with the goal, Scholing 0, Marlow 0. Amongst the scores, and there's a game tomorrow at Basingstoke between Winchester and Gosport Borough in the Southern League. Winchester still waiting to move for the ground to be ready for them to start playing at their home ground again. Long ball forward for Weymouth, for Linton to try to chase. He's almost kept up with the ball, but it was a good header away from Hemel, and then they clear their lines. Linton impressed me when he was on loan last year from Yeovil. I thought he was a great signing to make. We'll talk about him in a moment. Some good skills from Weymouth in the middle, which involved Thompson and Bearwish and now McCoy. But they're going backwards rather than forwards. That's the problem. Rowan looking for the long ball. What are his options? He's now into Hemel's half and tried to float one down the left wing, and he's got it all wrong, and that's just going to be a goal kick to Hemel. Hempstead Town. Yeah, Linton looked really good last season. I'm glad they signed him. He's looked dangerous today, but he's, as you say, he's out on the right. He's not seen that much of it, but a good acquisition.
Yeah, very good. It's the end of last season. He really did step up to the plate, didn't he? Hence why they've signed him. He's a strong lad as well. Knows where the goal is. He's playing sort of slightly wide, or he's getting into wider positions. I'd like to see him more centrally, if he can be, because that's where he's best at, knows where the goal is, and I'm sure he'll come good.
Also in the Wessex Football League, Portland United are one up on their travels today at Fareham Town. Lots of the Wessex League teams are still in the FA Cup, so we'll keep an eye on how they get on. There's also a Southampton area derby between Stoneham and Millbrook. There's a Salisbury derby between Bemerton and Laverstock. And in the next round of the Cup, that's when our Southern Premier teams enter, the likes of Dorchester and Havant and Waterlooville. They'll look forward to the draw on Monday for the first qualifying round of the FA Cup. Weymouth are a goal behind. Rowan again tries a long ball forward up towards Linton. Again, it's Wishart who wins the header again it's Williams who gets the ball away. Two added minutes to go. It's just all been a bit samey, a bit, you know, just what happened there. Long ball for Rowan up towards Linton. It's the same defenders that win the ball and get it away. And Weymouth need to change something here, because at the moment they are, Hemel look comfortable and perhaps the more likely team to have an attack.
Yeah, obviously Bobby Wilkinson will be the happier of the two by far, the way he's have contained this Weymouth side. Weymouth have been really poor. I'm sure Mark Moseley won't be happy with this. The standard set, it's pretty poor, and they have to improve second half if they're going to get anything out of this game.
Time running out for Weymouth. It's not been a very good half. Hemel will be delighted with their half, and a slip at the back almost puts in German. Actually does give a chance for a shot to come in. It's blocked from Barzi. They're going for a second goal of Hemel Hempstead as we come to the end of the half. Williams out to the right hand side to Teddy Howe. Howe against his former club. Can't get past Greenwood at the moment. Williams back to Smith. I think they're going to, are they going to eat up the last few seconds, or are they going to launch one last attack? Weymouth are, just be happy, I think, to hear the whistle and go in one behind. One more attack. This could give a chance to Cerulli, who takes a shot from an angle, and it's never going to trouble anybody, and it is a goal kick. And that, surely we're going to see Gary Parsons' half-time whistle, I think, as soon as Terrell gets this ball launched forward. Disappointing half, just one effort on goal. It was on target from Francis Amati, but Mark will need to get into that dressing room and change a few things.
Yeah, definitely. And I don't think he'll do it straight away. He might give it 10 minutes, but certainly Hemel have been the better side. Certainly they've edged it. They look more sharp, or they look organised. And fair play to Bobby Wilkinson. He's got this team well drilled today. They have picked some nice passes as well and played the better football out there too, which has surprised me. So it'll be an interesting chat in the dressing room for Mark and his team.
Well, the half-time whistle has gone, and it is Hemel who lead deservedly and comfortably. They are one to the good. Hutch and I, our friend Dil Butch, has given us some stats. I think they tally with mine. Hemel have had 4 shots on target, 1 off target. Terra's having 1 shot on target and 2 off. 5-3 is the corner count in favour of Hemel Hempstead. They've both had 6 free kicks each, and that one yellow card was shown to Ben Tompkins of Hemel. If it stays like this, this will be a 3 points, a first win for Bobby Wilkinson as Hemel manager, and a comfortable win for Hemel. Of course, we've got 45 minutes to see if that will change. Mark Moseley, this is game number 7 since he became manager again, and he's still looking for the first win, and maybe he saw this as the opportunity to get that one. Hutch, it hasn't been a classic. You think everyone sort of turns up with expectation for the opening game, but the crowd might need to play their part the second half, but definitely Weymouth's players need to play their part as well.
Absolutely. I think it's about Weymouth players playing the part first and getting the crowd going. That's what the crowd want to see. Listen, it's very early days, isn't it? I mean, second game in, a long way to go, but Mark will be really disappointed with what we've seen probably last week, a bit of pre-season, and today especially, especially against the next Weymouth manager. Everyone will want to beat him as well. So, yeah, long way to go, but different 45 minutes coming up, hopefully, and we see a bit more of an improvement. There's just been no fluency to Weymouth at all in that half, and hopefully it'll improve second half.
Let's have a look at some of the half-time scores in the FA Cup with teams in the south. Shaftesbury and Melksham is 0-0. Shaftesbury, or I think we say it Shaftesbury in this part of the world. The North Dorset team are 0-0 against their Wiltshire neighbours. Millbrook are 1-1 at AFC Stoneham in the FA Cup. I think that might constitute a surprise if it was an away win. Porchester are goalless in the FA Cup against, I think they've got Westbury United today. They are goalless against a team from a higher division. Baffin's Milton Rovers are 1-0 up at half time. in the FA Cup. And just take a look at who else we got in the FA Cup. Sherborne Town. They are 1-1 against Westfield in the FA Cup. Some of our smaller teams, we wish them all well in the FA Cup. We'll have more scores, more analysis from Hutch, commentary of the second half. For now, we'll head back to Jordan Clark, who's commentating on AFC Bournemouth.
Over on the right side, by the touchline, Marcus Tavernier will deliver left-footed. It's going to be curling. It's towards the back post. There's way too much on it. It bounces out of play. In fact, it had already gone out of play before it bounced. Goal kick to Nottingham Forest. They lead the Cherries by a goal to nil. BBC Radio Solent.
I think he'd be getting one or two words from the centre-backs about that one. Didn't even give them a chance to leap for the ball. Just straight behind for a goal kick.
Goal kick taken short and then sent long by Sales, the goalkeeper offside. For Forest. Flag up for offside. Michael Oliver can let play continue. He was, but then it didn't fall for Bournemouth, so pull it back for the free kick.
Yeah, I think when half-time comes, which is not unusual in terms of what the manager usually does, he does change things at half-time. He puts wingers for wingers on.
You got another 5 minutes yet, Willow.
But I'm already thinking about that, and I'm also thinking definitely Christie in the centre of midfield.
First Scott. Willow?
Yes, sorry. I thought
for
you said
Scott, yeah.
Scott was first.
Here's Alanga inside the centre circle. Gives White. Takes the ball away from him. Advancing down the left now. Hudson-Odoi receives the pass from Gibbs White inside the Bournemouth area, onto his right foot, shoots low, saved by Neto, palmed into the danger area again, this time Ouattara gets it away. Now Bournemouth can break through Tavernier, long ball forward, Sinisterra in behind, one-on-one with the goalkeeper, Sinisterra through the legs of the keeper, not quite, oh I thought he'd snuck that through.
Well, he's given the corner, the referee.
Sells managed to close his legs just in time and managed to squeeze the ball away, and then with a bit of help I think from one of the defenders, it was right behind the steel pillar in front of us, they put it behind for a Bournemouth corner. What a breakaway from one end to the other. Neto with the save, palmed it back in towards the penalty spot. Ouattara with some really brave defending there to get the ball away. Eventually it found its way to Sinisterra at the other end of the pitch. He just couldn't squeeze the ball through the legs of Sells.
Oh, it's his backside, hasn't it, going through?
I think you're right, Will. I think it was his backside in the end. The backside of Matt Sells saves Nottingham Forest, denies Bournemouth an equaliser. They have a corner, though. Right-footed from Lewis Cook. And again, third time we've seen that now from Bournemouth. It's over the head of everyone. It's way too deep. And it's straight out of play again for a goal kick to Nottingham Forest. Set pieces just not good enough at the moment for the Cherries.
After we've just been bigging them up, saying, that, well, they scored from a corner. But, like you say, three to go behind the goal. That's not what we want at all.
And we welcome listeners from 96.1 FM in our Hampshire frequencies. Here at the City Ground, it's Nottingham Forest 1, Bournemouth 0. We're playing 11 minutes of stoppage time. We've got about another three to go after a serious injury to Danilo, the Nottingham Forest midfielder, very early on in this game. It's Chris Wood's goal in the 23rd minute that separates the two sides. Here come Bournemouth down the left-hand side, though. Ouattara, 18 yards out, low ball into the box, looking for Sinisterra. It's cleared by Forrest and out of play for a throw into the Cherries halfway inside the Forrest half. Bournemouth have had the ball in the back of the net. Dongo Ouattara with the equaliser that was disallowed for offside after a brilliant set-piece routine from the corner between Lewis Cook and Marcus Tavernier. Couldn't quite time the pass in the run, though. VAR chalking it off for offside. And just a few moments ago, Lewis Sinisterra nearly squeezing the ball through the legs of Matt Sells with Bournemouth on the break. They've got it over on the right-hand side now, and Antoine Semenyo. Semenyo starting the day in the number 9 position. He's now on the right wing.
Played
Lewis
everywhere.
Sinisterra playing through the middle. In fact, it's Ouattara there at the moment. Gets up, wins the header. Back out to Semenyo. Early cross to the edge of the box. Finds Tavernier, brings it under control. His shot is charged down by Willy Bolly. And then Alex Scott wins it back really well for Bournemouth. He gets brought down and fouled. It'll be a free kick to the Cherries. About 25 yards out, maybe a touch more, central position. Alex Scott did really well there to win the ball back and then had his ankles clipped.
Yeah, he does that well, them little tackles. He just pokes his toe and he comes out. This is going to be too far for a straight shot. You can't score from there.
Well, you say he does it well. Really good, isn't it? Moving the ball again quickly after he's won it back, which then draws in those fouls. Are you surprised? We're talking about the set pieces, that he's not been on set pieces. I remember us raving about his delivery last season.
I thought that was one of the reasons he was put in the side for his set plays. But I think they're going to try a shot as well. But there's 18. Is it another
30 yards?
It's got to be, hasn't it?
I said 25, but I think it's a touch more. It's just right of centre. Tavernier's your left-footed option. Alex Scott is stood there as well as the right-footed option. Adam Smith looks like he's lining up a thunderbolt as well. It's Tavernier. It's curling. It's not quite into the top corner. There was just not enough pace on it. That was where it was heading, but Sales was able to get across and claim it pretty comfortably in the end.
Comfortably? He caught it with two hands.
Well, he palmed it down into the ground.
He nearly had to go backwards for it. No, you're never going to score from there.
Marcus Tavernier fought otherwise, but wasn't able to execute. Nottingham Forest 1, Bournemouth 0. The 11 minutes of stoppage time nearly up here at the City Ground. There's a langer down the right-hand side for Forest. Cleared long towards Chris Wood by Bolly. Wood nods it down to Gibbs White. Then Yates driving forward, has his ankles clipped by Lewis Cook. And that is going to be a free kick. And we said it was probably Lewis Cook's final warning for one a few moments ago. This time he does go into Michael Oliver's book. First booking of the afternoon, yellow card for the Cherries midfielder, Lewis Cook.
Yeah, it's a fair cop on that one. Referee quite right. Lewis know what he's doing. He's just going to go a bit careful now. Don't want any sending offs.
About halfway inside the Bournemouth half. Pretty central position. Anthony Alanga will take. Willie Bolly stayed back for Forest. They've sent Murillo forward. Alanga into the area. Howson gets up and heads clear. And there is the half-time whistle here at the City Ground. And the opening game of the season for Bournemouth. They find themselves behind again away at Nottingham Forest. But we know in the past they've come here and fallen behind and still come away with the 3 points. It was Chris Wood who opened the scoring in the 23rd minute. Neto palming the ball away, not out of the danger area. Wood with the tap-in to give Forest the lead. Bournemouth then equalised through Dongo Ouattara. That was chalked off for offside on Lewis Cook. And just a few moments ago, Lewis Sinisterra with Bournemouth on the break, very nearly squeezing the ball through Matt Sells' legs. But they're going a goal down at half-time. John Williams, your thoughts on that first half?
Yeah, a lot of work to do. I'm sure there'll be some changes, if not during half-time, just after half-time. Boys have got a lot of work to do to get back into this game.
Half-time here at the City Ground, Nottingham Forest 1, Bournemouth 0.
This is BBC Radio Solent Sport.
Well, not a good day so far for our two Premier League sides. At half-time, both are losing 1-0. AFC Bournemouth conceding away at Nottingham Forest.
Alanga and Wood comes back to Yates. It's spilled by Neto and it's poked in by Chris Wood, who wheels away in celebration. And it's Nottingham Forest who take the lead in this Premier League opener. Chris Wood with a tap and in the end, really. Nottingham Forest 1, Bournemouth 0.
As for Southampton, things were looking okay for them when this happened.
Oh, what's going on now? Brereton Diaz has dropped to the floor after contact from Fabian Scher. Off the ball, he's gone down again, and it is all kicking off on the pitch at St James's Park. And Craig Pawson is giving a red card to Fabian Scher. Scher is sent off.
Paul has got in touch to say McCarthy is a liability with his feet. We have to spend decent money and a quality goalkeeper in as well. Hello as well to this text who says, miss football, listening to Radio Solent, but if Saints are to have a good season, we need a new keeper. Sorry, but McCarthy isn't the best. Hoping for a good second half. There's certainly a theme going on with that one. 81333 on the text. Solent, your first word, wherever it is you support. WhatsApp 08000 321333. Again, Solent, your first word. Tweet us at Solent Sport. Alan from Chepstow's a Bournemouth supporter, says it's good to be back and a good start for Bournemouth. Shame about the Forest goal. Let's hope the second half is better. It's one of three live commentaries this afternoon, kicking off at 3 o'clock in the National League South. Weymouth are in action at home to Hemel Hempstead, managed by ex-Terrors boss Bobby Wilkinson, and Hemel Hempstead currently have a 1-0 lead. While in the league above, in the National League, Eastleigh are 2-1 down at home to AFC Fylde. Fylde were 2-0 up, Taylor getting a goal back. Spitfires, who won their opening day at Maidenhead, have lots of work to do. We'll go through all the non-league scores around the country before our second half matches gets underway on the home of live sport across the south.
BBC Radio Solent Sport.
Upload. Get yourself on the BBC.
Saturday evenings from 6, we're taking you on a journey into your imagination.
I'm dead.
You were.
Upload, a treasure trove of creative audio made by you, and it's your front door to the BBC. Drama.
No, Cara, don't!
Poetry.
Popcorn, who do you think you are, as if they don't pre-mix it? What? They do? Idiots.
Comedy.
Take a seat. Okay. Unexpected item in bagging area.
Everything is welcome and sent to us via bbc.co.uk/upload.
Upload.
Saturday evenings from 6 on BBC Radio Solent.
Ian Wilding.
BBC Radio Solent Sport.
So, a very good afternoon. I'm here at Fratton Park, which was a 12:30 kickoff earlier. That was our earlier game where Portsmouth suffered, or Portsmouth drew, I should say, 0-0 against Luton. Luton would reduce to 10 men, the goalkeeper being sent off, but 0-0 is how it finished. Pompey with 2 points from two matches. So, let's round up what's happening elsewhere then in the Premier League. So, with Newcastle scoring just before half-time there, Joel Linton's goal, McCarthy's mistake, Newcastle 1, Southampton 0, and Nottingham Forest 1, Bournemouth 0. It's Arsenal 1, Wolves 0 as well. That goal came on 25 minutes. Havertz with a goal there, and Brighton have a 1-0 lead away at Everton on their opening day of the season, Potoma getting a goal there for the Seagulls. Elsewhere then in the Championship, earlier on, result, Derby 1, Middlesbrough 0. Portsmouth Luton here finished goalless, so too did West Brom against Leeds. Other 12:30 kickoffs. Those are the three. We'll go through those in a second in League 1, but these are 3 o'clocks now. Bristol City 2-0 up at home to Millwall. Burnley 2, Cardiff 0. Norwich 0, Blackburn 1. Blackburn looking to make it back-to-back wins after their opening day against Derby. Norwich not got off to a good start to the campaign at all. Plymouth Hull City is goalless. Sheffield United have a 2-0 lead at home to Queen's Park Rangers. It's also Swansea 1, Preston 0. And Watford against Stoke is 0-0 as well. We'll go through some other scores as well soon, right around the country from League 1 downwards. But Eastleigh 1-2 against AFC Fylde. Fylde have a 2-1 lead away at Eastleigh in the National League. As you say, in the National League South, Weymouth 0, Hemel Hempstead 1. Elsewhere then in non-league football, in the Southern League Premier South right now, it's Poole Town 0, AFC Totten 1. Scott Rendell getting a goal for Totten, looking to make it 3 wins in 3. Totten big title favourites this season. Charlie Austin looking to get a goal today as well against his former club. Basingstoke Dorchester is goalless. Gloucester City have a 1-0 lead at home to Wimborne, who've won their first two games of the campaign, having been newly promoted. It's also Havenham Waterlooville 0, Plymouth Parkway 1. The Hawks have got some work to do there. And Jake Hesketh, the former Southampton and Eastleigh man, has scored for Scholing. They have a 1-0 lead at home to Marlow. In the Southern League Division 1, Bashley are 1-0 down at Cinderford at half-time. Bashley's game against Falmouth was called off due to implementation of their drainage system being delayed last weekend, and Bashley currently trail by a goal to nil. Well, in the FA Cup preliminary round, it's Baffin's Milton Rovers 1, Shepton Mallet 0. Westbury United and Porchester is 0-0. Millbrook, who've got their first ever season in the FA Cup, are 1-0 up away at AFC Stoneham. It's also goalless between Shaftesbury and Melksham. Westfield 1, Sherborne 1, and Thatcham 1, Andover New Street 2. Couple of games tomorrow as well in non-league football. Winchester City against Gosport in the Southern League Premier South. That one's at Basingstoke, 3 o'clock kickoff. And in the FA Cup tomorrow, Hanworthy Recreation are going up against Poulton Rovers. In cricket tonight as well, Southern Brave in action. The men, they're at Kensington Oval from 6 o'clock to take on Birmingham Phoenix in their 100 eliminator. We're expecting the players to come out imminently on the pitch as well at St James's Park, where Southampton are away at Newcastle United for their season opener. They trail by a goal to nil, Southampton, and now let's cross over to your commentary team on our Hampshire frequencies. Your summariser, Joe Tessam, your commentator, Adam Blackmore.
Thank you
here
very
on
much,
other
Ian.
Frequencies.
Welcome back, everybody. Saints have got work to do. Sugawara has gone
over hit, and Teddy Howe's not happy with himself. It looked a good ball when it left his boot. That's the third time I've said that today, Hutch. Good ball, and it's ended up being over hit. I'm going to have to learn to wait and see.
Yeah, absolutely. Looking at Teddy Howe there on the right, for Hemel, obviously ex-Weymouth, did well for them last season. Got another lad on the left for Weymouth who's on the bench today, Leo Hamlin, who I thought had a very good season, a decent prospect, but Matt Mosley seems to have favoured Ben Greenwood over him, so that'll be interesting. Yeah, but good strength and depth there on the left, because Hamlin is a decent player.
Down the left hand side come Hemel. Weymouth have to tidy it up, and Genesini does very well to tackle and win the ball back. And then hopeful ball into the middle is controlled well by McCoy, who plays a lovely ball to the left-hand side where there's lots of space. And here comes Greenwood. Ball into the area is cleared. Let's go through the two teams. Billy Terrell keeps goal for Weymouth. Brooklyn Genesini, Ben Greenwood, Jordan Thompson and Corey Jordan and Charlie Rowan at the back. Josh McCoy and Tom Berwish sitting in front of them. And then we've got Ewan Pollock, Francis Amati, Malachi Linton making up the 11. Subs are Hamblin, Robinson, Torre, Brooks and Salifu. I would imagine if it continues in this vein, they might bring on Torre, who has been an impact player since joining the club. This is a good move. This is Jordan through the middle. Greenwood on this left-hand side. Weymouth keeping the ball. Rowan plays it along the deck, tries to get it into Linton. Hemel clear their lines. Hemel's team, Craig King in goal. Jack Davies, Dan Wishart, Ben Tompkins, Teddy Howe, Kyle Ajayi, who scored the goal. Players at the back, then we've got Chris Smith and George Williams, Brandon Barzi, Alfie Cerulli, and here come Weymouth cutting into the area. They win a corner. Ricardo German is the other player, but he's given a goal kick. That was a terrific move down the right hand side, a nice Linton crossing it into the 6 yard box, but the last touch must have been off the Weymouth player because it is a goal kick. Achofano, Wiltshire, Curran Brown, Cook Appiah and AB, the substitutes for Hemel. What was your take on that decision, Hutch?
Yeah, definitely looked like a corner, didn't it? But that's where we want to see Linton in that 18-yard box. Made a lovely sort of run, lovely slide rule pass from Thompson, getting him in. And he's tried to cut it back, but it's definite corner. But referee and linesman didn't see it that way.
One nil the lead. Just clearing up some scores from half time, looking around the grounds. Eastleigh got a goal back before the break. They're only 2-1 behind in the National League. Home to Fylde. Jake Taylor got a goal back. Tottenham leading at Poole. Charlie Austin is starting for Tottenham against his former club, Poole. Former Premier League star. And Scholing got a late goal through Jake Hesketh at the end of the first half. Salisbury's goal court scorer against Slough, Josh Hedges. And in the FA Cup, Millbrook, Baffins Milton Rovers, Andover New Street, all winning ties. Three sides from the Wessex League. Andover New Street would be causing an upset if they continue to win at Thatcham Town. Isthmian League, Thatcham Town losing at home to Wessex League and over New Street. Here it's Hemel, good value for their lead with the ball out on the left hand side between them. Wishart and Cerulli combined to give it away, but Wishart's managed to get it back. He's down the left-hand side. He's tremendously strong, and he's won a throw parallel with the edge of the penalty area over on the left-hand side. What have the Terriers lacked so far? Is it leadership? Is it creativity? What's been missing so far?
Just a lack of cohesion, I think, Cliff, as well. They just look a bunch of strangers out there. There's no sort of combinations. There's no little patterns of play, like five or six passes. You know, it's just really, really flat. Whether they haven't bought into what Mark Moseley wants them to do so far is another question. It is early days, as I say, but they just don't look a team that they've played together over a few games, really. I mean, pre-season, they've had a good few games, but they still don't seem to have bought into what Mark Moseley wants at the moment.
Terrell, the goalkeeper, who's made at least three good saves in this game so far, gets it up to his centre-forward, Linton. Back into the Hemel half, where Terriers have the ball. Laying it around the back. Rowan's thinking what his options are. McQuaid finds Thompson. Rowan sweeps it forward. Linton's not going to be there. Jack Davies first to the ball. Ajayi at the back's got a lot of time for Hemel, the goal scorer. Plays a ball forward for German to try and chase. Thompson's going to get there first, but they're jockeying for the ball out by the corner flag. German does very well to play it back to Wishart. Ball into the area, and it's eventually finding its way through to Terrell in Weymouth's goal. Alfie Cerulli couldn't really get his feet round the ball properly. He got the touch, but it didn't threaten Weymouth at all. And Cerulli signing in the summer from Billericay, his second spell at the club. He's been with Braintree and Witham, and given that they've got at least three forwards on the bench, I don't know if he's looked quite as dangerous as German up front for them, Cerulli. But anyway, he's possibly looked just as dangerous as the Weymouth forwards, and his team are a goal up. Terrell finds Rowan. Rowan plays ball forward to McQuaid, and McQuaid isn't going to get there. It was Teddy Howe who got there first. Howe went down one in a foul. There was no foul. Play carries on. Rowan, hopeful ball forward for Linton. Who's going to get there first? The keeper's out. He's dropped it. He gathers it at the second attempt. The ref says he was fouled. I think that's the wrong decision. And the goalkeeper takes the free kick quickly. Linton is down holding his head. I don't think he gave away a foul, but he is hurt.
Yeah, it just seemed to come in together, didn't it, between the keeper, Ajayi and Linton. And Linton stayed down. I don't think it was a foul, but just to come in together. Keeper won the battle. But from Hemel's point of view, I'm sure Bobby Wilton's will be just happy for them just to sit in, contain Weymouth, and maybe catch them on the break as the game goes on. Weymouth will be looking to push forward, and I think that will be the plan from certainly Hemel Hempstead and Bobby Wilkinson's point of view. Looks as though Linton will be okay, but as I say, they've got a few on the bench with Torre. Seems to be more an impact player for Weymouth. Has been more sort of positive and influential when he's come off from the bench, so hopefully that'll be something that Mark Moseley in the next 10-15 minutes will be looking at.
So the injury to Linton, and he's probably been their more promising, one of the more promising Weymouth players out there. We don't want to see him go off, but it has given a sort of a water break where there are instructions, like a bit like a timeout, and Terrell in goal came all the way over for his water bottle and did a bit of finger wagging at some of his maybe forward players. Bradley Asagba there talking to Tom Bearwish. Bearwish remembers to throw the water bottle off the pitch. Play will carry on with Craig King to take the free kick on the edge of the penalty area. All in red, the goalkeeper rolls it out to his defender Ben Tompkins, who's on a yellow card. Cerulli tries to get German going forward. It's going to be too easy, I think, for Charlie Rowan. And now Rowan and Greenwood combined, but they've got the Tudors players snapping at their heels. They've got to go backwards rather than forwards. Teddy Howe kept the pressure on. And now it's Cerruti's got the ball out by the right wing. He played it into the area, but fortunately for Weymouth, there was no green shirts there, and Bearwish plays it back to his keeper, and the keeper got a bit lucky with a hash clearance. Hemel in possession of the ball, keeping the pressure on in Weymouth's half. That clearance could have gone anywhere.
Yeah, he's very lucky there, Tom Bearwish. They just look lacklustre, Weymouth, all over the park. Don't look sharp at all. Need a bit of a rocket up the backsides at the moment, I think, because it's certainly not good enough at the moment. You can actually hear, I think, Mark Moseley's at the back of the stand here. We can't see him, but I can hear him shouting from the back of the stand, orders out to his bench and onto the pitch. So he's getting a bit vocal.
And I think maybe that he needs to. They're back at home on Tuesday against Stubborn. Defeat for the opening home game. You never know, a rousing finish here might attract more fans on Tuesday night. A bit of a damp squib might have the opposite. Mark Moseley won 81 of his 145 games in charge of Weymouth in his first spell with a 56% win ratio. Two promotions there. This is game number 7 since coming back, still awaiting the first victory. And I'm sure many of us thought it might come today, but Hemel have got other ideas. This would be their first win under Bobby Wilkinson, and they would be unbeaten with 4 points from the opening 2 games if it stays like this. Terrell goes long for the Terrors. Good header at the back from Ajayi, but Linton may get a chance. Ajayi gets it away from him again. They've lost it in the middle. This is what's the referee given a foul there for? I don't quite understand what's happened there, because the visitors lost the ball. And is this a bounce ball? Did the referee lose his whistle there? I don't know what happened there. There didn't seem to be a foul either way. Hemel lost the ball, and Weymouth were looking to capitalise, and the ref stopped play to give a bounce ball. Looking for a penalty in the area. Marty for Weymouth thought he was being held. Referee's having none of it. Hemel launch a long one. It might bounce kindly for German. There's two defenders around him. One is Thompson. German gets the better of the bounce. Shooting chance may be coming up here. He's taken too long. Back to Barzi, who shoots. And it's just over the crossbar. Best effort of the half. And since the double save, at least. And another chance comes the way of the visitors. Barzi over the top on about the hour mark. That was close.
Yeah, that's what the Hemel will be looking to do. Like I said, catch them on the break, on the counter, and then nearly paid off there with Barzi having a good effort at goal. I've actually just seen Mark Moseley's actually in front of us in the director's box over there, so he's quite close to the pitch, so I'm sure the players will be able to hear him.
Yep, I think I can see. Yeah, there he is. The sort of the front row of the stand in the director's box watching his team. Ball forward. Oh, Amati goes down whilst chasing that ball. Now, is that, has he picked up an injury there? And may Weymouth have to make their first change? He seems to be in a lot of pain there. Moseley, I don't know if he's giving radio instructions to the bench or whether he's shouting at the team, but will the referee stop play for the injury? Amati's now holding his head. It wasn't a head injury, but if you hold your head, it becomes one, and then they have to put the ball out of play. Yeah, and player down, maybe the chance for the first change.
Yeah, I think it's more entertaining watching Mark Moseley actually screaming at his troops here. He's gone sort of down as far as he can, as close to the dugout, to give some more instructions. But I think he's trying to tell them, the players, they're playing to get up the pitch more from the back three, back four. So he needs to squeeze the game a bit more, I think, put the onus on Hemel Hempstead, keep them in their half, and take the onus to them, if you like. But Don't know how long we've got left. It's about half an hour. Hemel Hempstead are looking still very, very comfortable at the moment. How many shots has their keeper King had to make? I think they've had one shot on target, have they? If that, so it's stats-wise very disappointing. It still passes me a piece of paper.
Shots on target, one for Weymouth. That was Amati, who's the player injured. His shot was on target, two off target. And five chances for Hemel, four of them on target and one off. One of them, of course, finding the back of the net. Amati signed in the summer. Ayr United, I think, was his most recent club. He also played for Aldershot, Farnborough, Hampton Hayes, Braintree and Slough. He's back on his feet, but I don't know if he seemed to pull something there, because it was sort of off the ball that he went down, wasn't it?
Yeah, it didn't look much contact, so whether it was a calf or a hamstring, not so sure, but he's just having a couple of little shuttles up at the far side, and he doesn't seem to be in too much discomfort, so I think he'll probably continue. I'm sure Torre, though, is chomping at the bit.
Bring on Ezio. That could be... Maybe I've been a bit lucky when I saw his debut when he scored two, and we were here against Havana Waterlooville, I think the last Terrors game we covered, when he came off the bench to score. Looking at the goalkeeper situation, we got Gerard Benfield out on loan at Dorchester, dislocated his finger on the opening game, so he had to miss the second game. He had to go off to hospital. And then, is it Callum Smalley? He's on loan at Hamworthy Recreation, and he got injured as well. So goalkeepers number two and three have been in the wars when they've been out on loan.
Yeah, you don't want to be a number two or three, do you? A bit of a jinx, but glad to see that young Smalley's back. It was quite a concern. I saw on Twitter coming through that the game had been abandoned, but luckily and thankfully, I believe he's okay.
Long ball forward for Weymouth, trying to get Amati through it. The ball might fall loose. Might give an opportunity for Pollock. Working it out to the right-hand side now. Jordan Thompson out to the right wing. Into the middle, to the 16. But they couldn't keep hold of it. Pollock couldn't keep hold of it. And it's a throw to Weymouth back on the halfway line. Also seeing this week, former Weymouth manager Steve Claridge standing down as manager of Wessex League side Fleetlands due to personal reasons. Last season they got to the playoffs. This season they've started with three defeats out of three, and Steve Claridge no longer manager there. Obviously someone very well known in this part of the world.
Yeah, I know Steve quite well, played with him for a couple of seasons. Great blow. I'm quite surprised about that, because I went to a dinner with him this year actually, and he was really happy in his work at Fleetlands. Young set of lads up there working hard with him, and seemed really in a good place, Steve, with it. But we'll watch this space with that one, whether there's something come up a bit further up the ladder. I'm not so sure, because I know he wants to get in and wants to go back and manage at a very good level, so we'll watch the space on that. But good luck to him, whatever he decides.
Await for the FA Cup draw on Monday to pick next Saturday's and the following Saturday's commentary games. Today we've picked Weymouth against Hemel Hempstead. It's not a classic, and Hemel are comfortably leading, although it's only 1-0. Weymouth trying to get back into this one. Thompson out to Bearwish on the right hand side, takes a shot from distance, hits the crossbar. That was so close, that was brilliant, but it hit the bar. Still not clear, curled wide in the end by Ewan Pollock. Pollock curled it wide, Bearwish shooting from distance off the bar.
I don't know, was it Genesini? I think I might be wrong. Was it Pollock? Genesini, yeah. Coming in from the right hand side. That's what we want to see from Genesini. That's what he's all about. I've heard good things about him. That's the first time we've properly seen him in the game. But need to get him on the ball as much as possible. Getting it there, left back. And that's a good positive bit of play there from Genesini. And that's what we want to see more from him, because we haven't seen enough.
Still 1-0, but that could be a wake up call for the home fans and the home players. Terrific effort. Off the crossbar and down again into play. Definitely the best bit of play we've seen so far from Weymouth. Sometimes you need someone to try and take the game by the scruff of the neck. Rowan for Weymouth. In his own half, plays a nice ball forward to Amati, who seems no worse the wear from the injury. Then Amati pulls the shirt of Barzi. Oh, they've given it to Weymouth. I thought it was a foul the other way. Weymouth will take that decision. And maybe you sense things are just starting to change.
Yeah, a little bit of magic. It's amazing what happens. The crowd are lifted straight away. You said, Cliff, about that the crowd lead lift the team, but it's the other way around, and that's happened with Genesini's effort. The crowd have got a bit more upbeat now and putting the onus onto Hemel Hempstead.
Free kick into the area from Greenwood, headed down. Shirt pulled in the box, maybe cleared in the end by Jack Davies. And now is breaking from one end to the other, and German plays a really good pass off to Brandon Barzi. He scored a goal last Saturday. He's not going for goal this time. He tries to put German back in. And Bearwish is back defending, getting it away. Down the right-hand side come Hemel with Teddy Howe. Howe into Cerulli. Oh, long-range shot takes a massive deflection off a Weymouth player's head. I think it was Wishart who took a pop, and it's hit Bearwish's head, and it's gone out for a corner. The referee's gone over to talk to the Bradley Asagba, gets the yellow card, the assistant manager for Weymouth. First yellow card for Weymouth goes to the man in charge today, obviously for something said.
Yeah, it must have been. Ref ran straight over, so obviously a few choice words from Badasagba. And he's got and found himself in the book as Hemel are about to make a couple of changes, it looks like. Also, I see Torre is getting ready as well for Weymouth, so there's going to be a few changes here.
21 minutes to go. Weymouth with that one effort off the bar. Only one of two efforts they've had today. Hemel's corner from the left-hand side is curled across. Good punch from Terrell. Out of the area, picked up by Barzi. Out to the left wing, flicked back into the middle. Thompson heads it away from Weymouth. But the visitors get the ball back. Good work from Davies, good work from Ajayi, and then a bad pass out to the left wing to nobody. And Weymouth get the ball back, and that will give us the break to make the changes. 12 and 16 are coming on for Hemel. They've got no numbers on the team sheet, so that's, we'll listen out for the announcements. So 9 is coming off. Ricky German. And it looks like it might be, so German's coming off, and 12 for 10. Number 10 is Alfie Cerulli, who I did predict might be one of the players to make way. 16 and 12 are on. And with no numbers on the team sheet, I might have to check in on social media to see who the players are coming in. It doesn't help when the team sheet hasn't got the numbers. But the Weymouth changes, we are going to see Torre and Robinson and Brooks coming on. A treble substitution. Ezio Torre, Calvin Brooks and Andreas Robinson all on. Josh McCoy going off. Tom Bearwish going off. The captain. So the captain goes off, I don't know, and there's 11 for 17, so Amati comes off for Calvin Brooks. So Calvin Brooks, this is appearance number 338, takes him level with Simon Brown on the all-time appearance list for Weymouth. Treble change, I think we needed to see Touré. Nice to see Robinson back after a long injury and Calvin Brooks back after an injury.
Yeah, who obviously both played under Mark Moseley in the championship winning sides, didn't they? So Mark Moseley knows them well, trusting them. So three fresh pairs of legs hopefully they can just bring that little bit of a spark. I like Robinson. He sits in there and he picks a pass. So maybe that's what they need at the moment. And obviously Torrey up front, great from coming off the bench. Influenced many games from coming off the bench. Scored goals, won games. So fingers crossed they can add something to it.
Joe Achofeno, one of the players on. Hemel announcing online one of their substitutions. And that is Achofeno touching it off. This is an opportunity. A shot is saved by Terrell. The two substitutes combine within seconds of coming on. Achofeno was on for German. And here's Achofeno again. They're looking so dangerous. The other substitute takes a hack. Another effort on target for Hemel, who are looking good. Hemel just keep the pressure on. Their substitutes seem to have galvanised them. Weymouth yet haven't touched the ball. Nice ball out to the right wing. Good control by Teddy Howes. Taking his time. The player's slipped in front of him. He's crossed it to the back post. It's a nice cross. Weymouth headed away. The offside flag is up. The other change was Trey on. So it's Trey Cook-Appiah, who's number 12, and Joe Achofeno, who's number 16. Those were the two changes. So it's 1-0 to Hemel Hempstead, who look the more likely team to score the next goal, but Weymouth not giving up. The four-figure crowd to start the season is good news. 1,030 here at the Bob Lucas Stadium. That's a good crowd. This is Calvin Brooks with his first attack on the right-hand side. Into the penalty area he goes. This is a good dribble. What's the end result? Nice cross to the back post. Howe's going to get there first. Edge of the area. They clear their lines and get it away. It's going to be a Weymouth throw back in their own half. We thought 900 to 1,000. It was 1,030. Always good when you get over 1,000.
Yeah, sounds better, doesn't it? And it's a decent crowd for this time of the year. As I say, it's August, a lot of people on holiday. Weather's not too bad. A lot of people go down the beach. It's normal. But we've just got to keep hold of the crowd. We've got the one who have to come back. I mean, prices are £18 now, which I find is extortionate, but the club have got a reason for that. For the budget, etc., and the running of the club, that's up to them. So it is a lot of money, but they've got to put on a better performance if they want the crowds to come back.
I know I mentioned earlier that it was 1-1 with Bournemouth at Forest. Well, it was only 1-0 at half-time. The goal must have got chalked off by VAR. Let's have a quick look how our other commentary games are going. Bournemouth are 1-0 down at Forest. Saints are 1-0 down at Newcastle. Newcastle did have a man sent off, but then went on to score the opening goal. In the National League, this could be a great story. Eastleigh are now 3-2 up after being 2-0 down. That would be a real turnaround and would make it two wins out of two for Eastleigh if they can hold on to that. Hemel looking really good. Here they come. Tompkins crosses into the air. It takes a deflection. It's lashed home by Joe Achofeno for goal number two. The dangerous substitute who used to play for Havant or Waterlooville, amongst others, may have put this game to bed midway through the second half. They've doubled the lead, deservedly so. Weymouth 0, Hemel Hempstead Town 2.
Yeah, like I say, just soaking up the pressure, and then when they get the opportunity to go forward, they do that, and they've probably killed this game off now. Probably the better side throughout, have to be honest with that. They look sharper, stronger, and it's a great finish again. Weymouth haven't tested the Hemel Hempstead keeper enough. I mean, we had a little sortie there. Calvin Brooks is very positive, got a good ball in. That's what they need to be, a lot more positive, look forward more. Don't mean by that long balls, but just breaking the lines, if you like, and it just hasn't happened today for Weymouth.
Achofeno making the difference. Well, a double substitution for Hemel at the same time that Weymouth made a treble substitution, and Hemel's substitutes have changed the game. Weymouth's ones haven't yet.
Absolutely, I said there is still time. Genesini's come over to this left side and he's lost the ball again, and Hemel are just breaking away again.
The Choffin, who's just scored one, he's down the right wing here. He's got no support. He's got two Weymouth players around him. He does very well to win the throw under those circumstances. Ball off of Greenwood. Andreas Robinson had a year out of the game, got injured playing for Gosport. Had a year out, but enticed back. He always thought he could come back. He's only 31. Second spell at Weymouth. And Calvin Brooks last season was on crutches watching from the stand, but he is back. The Choffin, who chases a loose ball down, trying to get the better of Greenwood into the area. Bearwish has got to defend well because Barzi was there looking dangerous, pushing him in the back. And then he's kicked the ball away, I think. So it is a yellow card for Brandon Barzi, either for the foul or for the descent that followed it. And a free kick to Weymouth, who are losing 2-0. Got 12 minutes to go. And just, to think they scored two goals on the opening day away from home, but they've only had two efforts here today in the whole of about 80 minutes. One was saved, one hit the bar, but there were no other real shots, even shots off target.
There's been a real lack of creativity from Weymouth's point of view. As I say, there's been no cohesion, no real patterns of play, combinations. And it's shown today, and you know the crowd are a bit restless now. And take nothing away from Hemel Hempstead, and they've been very professional in what they've done. Say they look the more sharper team, they've been organised and very, very strong.
Rowan breaks up an attack, but his through ball is charged down. This might give Hemel another chance, but Wishart's ball through to Ichofano was not a good one, and Terrell was potentially the contender for Weymouth's man of the match with about three or four good saves there. I can't really think of anyone else that would deserve that accolade. He gathers the loose ball.
Absolutely, Terrell by far. It could have been 2-0 start of the second half with a great double save he's made. Made a couple more saves as well, so you can't really pick anyone else out, really. I mean, Linton Stride worked hard up front, but you look at it, there's no one that stands out from a Weymouth point of view at all.
2-0 down, and a disappointing afternoon so far for the Terrors. Eastleigh are now 4-2 up against AFC Fylde. What a turnaround for the Spitfires, who are probably going to be up near the top after just two games and two wins. In this division, Salisbury still leads Slough 1-0. Aveley and Tunbridge is 2-2. Bath lead Welling 1-0. Hampton are 1 up at Chelmsford. Borehamwood are 2 up at Chesham. Dorking lead Chippenham 1-0. Enfield lead Western Supermare 1-0. Farnborough lead Torquay 1-0. Eastbourne are 1 up at Hornchurch. Truro are 1 up at Maidstone. Free kick on the edge of the area. Torre was fouled. I thought a yellow card was going. I think it's a spray. Salisbury still leads Slough 1-0. Truro are 1 up at Maidstone. St Albans and Worthing is 2-2. Here it is 2-0 to Hemel, and Weymouth have a free kick in a dangerous position.
Yeah, a really great opportunity for Weymouth to get back in the game. A couple of yards outside the box to the left-hand side of the goal as we look. Perfect for a right footer, a little clip over the wall. Curling effort, surely, I would have thought. Is it Rowan over the ball with Genesini? Would have thought Genesini's right peg. Been a nice little sort of floated curler, but we will see. There's three of them over the ball.
This could be a way for Weymouth to come back into the game. We've got about 10 minutes to go. It's a free kick. Genesini with the right boot, I think, is going to take this one. Here is a teammate up there with him. What's going to happen here? Free kick. Genesini to take. He takes the shot. He curls it wide of the target. Not far wide. We knew what he was going to try and do. Curled it over the wall, but wide of the left-hand post.
Yeah, half-decent effort. He's got to hit the target, though. Got to make the keeper work in those situations. Gone for a bit of power with the whip as well, and was always going over the bar. So comfortable in the end for the Hemel keeper.
Bobby Wilkinson looks like he'll leave the Bob Lucas Stadium with a big smile on his face. His last game in charge was in March when they beat the Terrors, beat Havant and Waterlooville 4-1. Hutch and I were here for that one. And after the game, Bobby departed the club. And he's returned today. I don't know if he's had a master plan or if he's set them up specifically or whether just Weymouth have been bad, but they've been the better team. And Ajayi in the first half with a header and a close-range goal from Ichofenu in the second, giving them a 2-0 lead. Another change, I think, is coming our way for Weymouth FC. Number 20 is coming on, Farid Salifu. He impressed in a pre-season, over pre-season in the trials. He's played for Hayes and Yedi and Gosport Borough before. Two teams that Mark Molesley has been involved with. Weymouth have another free kick with 8 minutes to go. Salifu is going to come on. This will be his full debut for the club. He didn't feature in the squad last week. But Salifu is on, and he would be an instant hero if he turned this one around. And coming off is Malachi Linton, who I think didn't have as much influence as the game went on. He seemed to be Weymouth's most dangerous player in the game, but I didn't see so much of him as the game proceeded.
Yeah, he worked hard, he worked very hard, didn't get much service, he can say that. He went looking for the ball at times in the wide areas, and now the big lads come on, got to be 6'4", 6'5", probably more. So I think it's going to be a case of just hitting him and getting scraps off him, knockdowns, anything you can to get something out of the game.
Free kick into the area, it's a brilliant header behind. There were four Weymouth players lining up, and Ben Tompkins, the teenage defender, heads the ball behind for a corner. Terrific defending from Tompkins, and Weymouth get a corner out on the far side. Tompkins only just joined them from Luton Town. Corner comes in for Weymouth, delivered to the near post, cleared easily by George Williams. Weymouth aren't really getting their set pieces right either. And needs to get a goal back here. Over hitting the cross there. Well, it might have stayed in. No, it's out. It's disappointing. There were three or four players in the area. The cross was disappointing from Jordan.
Yeah, very disappointing. There's been a lot of poor quality all over the pitch, really. Set pieces as well, you know, they haven't made them count. And again, Hemel will just be happy now just to sit back again, and it could be a case they could get a third here by just sitting back and catching Weymouth on the counter, because Weymouth have to push bodies forward. It's as simple as that if they want to get anything out of the game with about 6 to 10 minutes to go.
In the Southern Football League, Basingstoke lead Dorchester, Liam Ferdinand scoring, so Dorchester might taste their first defeat of the season. Wimborne are losing at Gloucester 1-0. Havant and Waterlooville have equalised at home to Plymouth Parkway. They're unbeaten from the opening two games. Totten still lead at Poole 1-0 through Scott Rendell. Totten would have three wins out of three if it stays like that. Scholing still lead Marlow 1-0. Jake Hesketh with the goal there. Tomorrow it's Winchester at home to Gosport. Their home is Basingstoke, if you were thinking of going to that game. And there's only one in the league below. We've only got one team in action today, and that's Bashley. I'll see if I can find a score for them. They were at Cinderford and they were one down at the break. They're now 2-1 up, so terrific start for Connor Whiteley and Stephen Walker scoring for Bashley. Bashley couldn't play their first two home games. They had to be postponed because of problems with laying the new turf. But they're on their way to an away victory today by 2-1. I mean, it's not done yet. We might have a grandstand finish, but what can we take away from this, thinking that we've got a game coming on Tuesday as well?
Yeah, they've got to react pretty sharpish for Tuesday, because there'll be no pushover against Chippenham, who are a decent side. It's back to the drawing board. I mean, the game isn't over yet, as you say. There is time, but the Hemel Hempstead are a professional outfit. They'll just kill this game off and see it out. I'm sure of that. But a lot of work for Mark Molesley and his backroom staff to to dig the teeth into after this performance. I'm sure he'll be very disappointed. As I say, there is time, but we'll see, and we'll discuss that at the end of the game.
Yeah, they lost the first game 3-2. They are losing the second game 2-0. For Hemel Hempstead, that would be 4 points on the board. 4 goals and a goal difference of +2. Be interesting to see if they do win, how Bobby Wilkinson celebrates at the whistle, whether he just runs down the tunnel or whether he gives the fist pumps or the waves to the crowd. Former Weymouth manager, almost 100 games in charge. Shot comes in, it's wide of the target, it deflects behind for a corner. Weymouth looking to get one back. Ezio Touré with a shot that deflects behind for a corner to Weymouth as the clock ticks down. Impact sub. Sometimes you wonder why he doesn't always start. Corner comes in for Weymouth. Is this a way back into the game? Thompson tries to make the header. It's still loose into the area. Brooks tries to hook it towards goal. He can't make contact. Hemel just put it out of play. Barzi tried to get a counter-attack going, but he overhit his pass, and it is going to be Weymouth who try and get back into this one. Genesini. Long ball up from the back towards Salifu. Couldn't quite win the header on. Mark Molesley still waiting for a win as Weymouth manager in his second spell at the club. 5 games last season produced 2 draws and 3 defeats. And only 1 game they scored in, actually. But this season they've started with a 3-2 reverse at Tunbridge, and they are 2-0 down at home to Hemel Hempstead Town. Long ball from Terrell, the goalkeeper, up towards Salifu. Couldn't get on the end of it again. Ochofano's got the ball in the centre circle for Hemel Hempstead Town. He's in no rush to go towards goal. He plays it back to Wishart, who puts it out of play for a throw. He went down making a noise, wanting a foul, but nothing given there. Pollock, the player. So, at least half a dozen players are new in this start, in this 11. Some youngsters let go by Bournemouth. But you think the Terriers might still need at least one more player?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, he'll always be looking to add more. If there's anything quality going, he'll be looking to snap it up. And for me, I mean, in the middle of the park, they're just missing something. They're lacking some of that person with the creativity who can pick a pass, as I've said, who can run a game, who can pull people around with him. That's what I feel is missing. You can say up front as well, but there's been no service at all, has there, for the front three today.
Here come Hemel looking to extend their lead. This is Trey Cook-Appiah out on the right wing. He's not really in any rush to get the cross in. As we get within a minute of the final whistle, or a minute of the 90 minutes, I'm sure there'll be lots of added time. Well, I was going to guess 5, and there is 5. 5 added minutes for Weymouth to try and spark their way back into this game. Mark Molesley had so much success in his first spell. 11 for 17 is the change. So Barzi goes off. And again, without numbers, I might have to rely on the social media of Hemel to tell me who's come on. But they've made a final change with 17 coming on for Brandon Barzi. I thought Barzi had quite a good game. And Weymouth making a change as time up on my stopwatch. And it's 3-4-15, so that's Pollock going off for Hamblin. I don't know if, well, a bit strange to bring on a defensive player for a forward one.
Slightly. Whether Hamblin can just, he's looking to get Hamblin in the game just to, with his lovely left peg, just to pick passes and long diagonal balls to the big fella. Maybe that's it, but it looks as though they've gone 3 at the back anyway now.
Weymouth taking risks now, as you might expect. 2 goals behind. This might be an opportunity. Corey Jordan tries to get it into Salifu. Five added minutes here. Cross comes in again. Header away by the goal scorer, Ajayi. Hamlin is on a run. What can he do? Oh, he gets past the man. He's in the penalty area. The cross was low to the near post and was blocked. So that was almost an instant impact from Leo Hamlin, the 21-year-old number three. Hamlin. Genesini called for the ball. Hamlin has seen it blocked by Hemel's latest substitute, the number 17. Kyron Wiltshire, the player on, who came on for Brandon Barsley. Long ball forward. Salifu tries to knock the header down to Rowan. The Tudors get it back. They've got four flags away, the away fans. Into the penalty area comes Ochofno. Really good skills. Waiting for some backup. Plays it out again to the left wing. Ochofno's now gone out to the left wing. Small away following with four large flags away behind the goal to the right are going to celebrate an away win. Unless something happens in added time. Weymouth will have a lot of work to do, a lot of soul searching. Another change. George Williams, who's had a really good game, coming off for Hemel Hempstead. And it's number 15 who's going to come on. Are there any positives you can take today, Hutch?
You might have to come back to me on that one, Cliff, because I'm trying to think, and maybe the goalkeeper's made some good saves. Other than that, you can't really pick any positives out at all. I mean, hardly any shots on target, just a poor all-round performance from Weymouth.
Hemel looking very comfortable. I think it's Connor Curran-Brown, the player who's come on. Looking at the stats for some positives as well, that Dill Butcher of the non-league paper's written, but they don't lie. It's been more chances, I think. More corners, more shots on goals, more goals for Weymouth. Well, I suppose one thing we could say, there hasn't been a yellow card for Weymouth. There's been at least three, I think, for Hemel, but... That isn't always a good thing either, is it?
Oh, good disciplinary record, I suppose. There you go.
A big improvement needed Tuesday when Chippenham Town will come to town. And Hemel fans listening in, your team has been on top pretty much. There was a 2 or 3 minutes from kickoff that you had to weather a storm, but now you scored on 13 minutes... and have looked the better team ever since. Maybe if Weymouth's effort that from Genesini that hit the bar had gone in, it would have been a different story. That would have been a way back into the game, but they've only really created two chances in the game, haven't they?
Yeah, not enough. You're at home as well. Big crowd here. Want to lift them. And there's just, like I say, it's been very flat out there from the first whistle.
Bit of a late tackle from Weymouth on Hemel. Didn't get spotted. Play carries on. And Hamblin plays a 1-2 with Genesini. Genesini's lost the ball. Ochofenu has dispossessed him. Now it could be 3 against 4. He's played the ball out of play. He tried to play it down the right wing to Teddy Howe, but didn't get it right. But Ochofenu, remember him when he signed for Havant & Waterlooville. From St Albans, he's an ex-league player with Northampton and joined the Tudors from Oxford City. They're trying to get another goal here, going forward. Curran Brown, their fourth substitute, tries to find Ochofenu. It's intercepted by Hamblin. This might be a break. Hamblin out to the right wing to try and get Jordan forward. The ball is cleared by the goalkeeper, doesn't get through to Farid Salifu. Salifu and Toure up there now. They haven't seen too much of the ball. In added time, Hamlin's ball forward. Toure nods it down. Rowan's going to pick it up. This might be a chance out on the left wing. Flicks it forward. Can Genesini be the first to the ball? No, it's Hemel clear. It's a throw to Weymouth. I kind of wish the way they started the first couple of minutes and ended the last few minutes, they could have done that throughout the 90.
Yeah, yeah, they've rallied a little bit at the end here.
Salifu's shot is blocked, and it's going to be easy, I think, for Wishart to get it away.
Yeah, so they've rallied a little bit, but it's been comfortable for Hemel, really, haven't they? They've got that perfect smash-and-grab-away victory, and they've thoroughly deserved it, really.
Out on the right side is Robinson. One of his teammates goes down. Flying move, but it's a throw, not a foul. And that was Pollock, who has won him a throw on the far side, which Calvin Brooks will take. Will it be a long throw into the box? No, he goes short to Robinson. Back to Brooks. Robinson, good delivery, headed down and away from Ajay. Rowan was up there, couldn't quite get on the end of it. An almighty clearance. And there's the final whistle, and you may hear some boos here at the Bob Lucas Stadium. It is a defeat for Weymouth on their opening home game. A victory for Hemel Hempstead Town. Bobby Wilkinson and his team swapping handshakes with the Weymouth bench. A disappointing afternoon for all concerned with Weymouth. They hit the bar once, they had one effort saved, but over 90 minutes that's not enough. And Hemel had a lot more chances than the two goals, and young Billy Terrell, the goalkeeper on loan from Bournemouth, kept the scoreline down, in all honesty.
Yes, could have been too early in the second half, couldn't he? He's had a good game, but I don't think any Weymouth player can look themselves in the mirror tonight and say, I've performed well today. It's been really, really poor. Very interesting. It was just to watch Bobby Wilkinson shake hands at the end there. He hasn't come onto the pitch, unless my eyes deceive me. I think he's gone straight down the tunnel. He's keeping out of the way, and I'm sure his glass of red wine will be tasting very nice tonight. Sure, he'll have a little smug, wry smile on his face after that today.
Yeah, I don't know if he'd done his homework and had a master plan, or whether Weymouth just didn't turn up. But any former manager coming to your ex-club and getting a victory so soon after leaving, I guess he will be very, very happy.
Yeah, it was obviously left a bit of taste in his mouth, I would have thought. I don't know. As I say, when he left the club, it came out of the blue in a way. So, but I'm sure Bobby's a professional man, and he'll be very professional in defeat, I'm sure. I don't know if you'll get a chance to speak to him or we'll listen to his interview, but the better side won, as we've watched the Hemel players go over to the fans. I think they thoroughly deserved it. They were sharper, more organised and stronger, and they've come here and they've done a job, and a very, very poor Weymouth performance today. And I'm sure Mark will be looking at things for Tuesday now. He's got a few things to look at, maybe make a few changes and shake it up a little bit.
I think he might need to. Hemel are playing on Monday against Aveley. Weymouth are here at home under the lights at the Bob Lucas on Tuesday against Chippenham, and they will need a much improved performance. Let's take a look at some of the other scores across non-league football. First of all, Eastleigh, because they were 2-0 down at home, and they've won by 4-2. They've turned it around. They were losing to AFC Fylde. Paul McCallum, their goal machine, who was supposed to be on his way out but has signed a new contract, has scored two of the goals. Chris Maguire and Jake Taylor also on target for the Spitfires. Brilliant stuff for them. In National League South, let's take a look at some of the scores. Who else were winners today? As well as Hemel Hempstead Town, comfortable 2-0 winners here at Weymouth. There were victories for Boreham Wood, 2-1 at Chesham. Dorking Wanderers 1-0 at home to Chippenham Town. Enfield beat Weston 1-0. Farnborough beat Torquay 1-0. Eastbourne won 1-0 at Hornchurch. And Salisbury did beat Slough by a goal to nil. St Albans and Worthing was 2-2. Chelmsford and Hampton and Richmond was 1-1. Avely and Tunbridge was 2-2. They are still playing at Bath, where Welling are 1-0 behind. They're still playing at Maidstone, where Truro are 2-1 up. But it's finished here. Weymouth 0, Hemel Hempstead Town 2. Just take a look at the Southern League, because as we say, we've got so many teams there. Basingstoke 2, Dorchester Town 0. Gloucester 1, Wimborne Town 0. These are results. A win for Hanwell over Supermarine, a win for Hungerford over Taunton. Both of those were 1-0. And Walton beat Merthyr 5-2. In games that are still being played, Tottenham 1-0 up at Poole. Scholding a 1-0 up against Marlow. The Hawks of Hammond and Waterloo Villa 1-1 against Plymouth Parkway. In the FA Cup, well, it's okay. In the FA Cup, I know Baffin's Milton Rovers are through to the first qualifying round. That draw is on Monday. And in the Southern League Division 1, Bashley were 2-1 up last we heard at Cinderford Town last time they tweeted. We're going to hand back to Jordan. AFC Bournemouth are still playing Nottingham Forest. Hutch and I will be back another time. It finished here. Weymouth 0, Hemel Hempstead Town 2.
Throw into Nottingham Forest just inside their own half. Down the left, Toffolo will take it down the line. Araujo gets up and wins the header. Then Christie's there with the header. Phil Billings trying to bring it down out of the sky. He's got his left foot about shoulder height. Does bring it under control. And again, Bournemouth try their right flank.
At 6'4", getting your foot that high is a difficult skill.
Impressive. Throwing again to Forrest. The Forrest left, this near side in front of Andoni Iraola's technical area. Araujo wins it back, but his clearance is charged down by Anderson. Out of play, throw into Forrest, and now they feel like maybe there's a chance. Taken quickly, Gibbs-White down to Awonyi. Left side of the box, Toffolo gets the cross in, charged down really well by Julian Araujo. Throw into Forrest.